Good afternoon, friends. We are facing unprecedented situation due to COVID-19 pandemic. Not only our country, the rest of the world, all over situation is same. I do have a conversation with a lot of my friends who are in North America and Western Europe. Everyone is facing these challenges. Two of my close cardiac surgeon who are in New York City, both of them, since last 2 months, they haven't done any cardiac surgery. They are doing their duties in CCU, managing the COVID patient who are on ventilators. I had a conversation with one of the friends in Harvard Medical Setup, and their observation is the same. In Germany, the cardiac surgery is down somewhere 30% of the original. Now, let's see that how in this pandemic, our cardiac patients are facing the issues and how much they are vulnerable because of these problems, and how we cardiovascular experts, cardiologists and surgeons are going to render our services to our patients who are in our follow-up, some of them who are the new patients, and patients who suffered with COVID and developed cardiac problems. Not moving. The screen is not, yes. Now, as we know that the fatality after COVID infestation is somewhere in the range of 2 to 3% worldwide. More than 80% of the patients who infected with this virus, they have very mild symptoms. In our country, there are a lot many asymptomatic patients roaming around. However, morbidity and mortality increases significantly with age, rising to around 8% among patients who are 70 to 79 year old, and around 15% in the patients who are more than 80 year of age. Case fatality rate for comorbid patients are higher than the average population. Patients who are suffering with a cancer, and if they get COVID, the mortality in the range of 5.6%. Patients who are hypertensive and then they get this virus infection, the mortality in the range of 6%. Chronic respiratory disease patients have got the mortality in the range of 6.3%. Diabetics, they are also having high mortality in the range of 7.3%. And of course, patients who are suffering with cardiovascular diseases and get viral infection, the mortality goes somewhere between 10 to 11%. Now, let's see the implication for patients with undergoing cardiovascular, who are having underlying cardiovascular problems. How they are supposed to prevent themselves that they don't get infection, and if somehow they get infection, how quickly they can be treated and they can escape from dreaded complication. Now, we advise that patients should take prophylactic measure like social distancing, continue all prescribed medication including ACE inhibitor and ARBs. Now, these patients who are in our follow-up need not to visit us in the hospitals and our clinics. Instead, we have to provide them teleconsultation so that we can avoid chance of getting intermingled with the COVID patients. Some of the patients who are aged and heart patients, they may get pneumococcal vaccine and influenza vaccine as advocated by ACC and AHA guidelines. Early identification, isolation of cardiovascular patients is really mandatory. Triaging has prioritized the treatment for COVID-19 patient according to underlying cardiovascular, diabetic, respiratory, renal, oncological or other comorbidities. Don't ignore acute myocardial infarction symptoms. Acute event like AMI can be underreported or undiagnosed due to prevailing bias towards diagnosis of COVID. Now, patients who has got cardiovascular problems, and if they get complication of COVID infection and they go into the hypertension or shock, it's very important to manage fluid balance very judiciously. Now, what we are following in our institution, this is very important. And this is also important that patients who are cardiovascular patients, they also present with breathing difficulty, chest pain or asthenia. While these three things are also symptoms of COVID patients. Sometimes cardiovascular patients get infection of COVID virus. So there is a combination of these symptoms, and it's very difficult to identify whether they have COVID or their manifestation is because of cardiovascular problems. Now, therefore, require a very tight multidisciplinary collaboration in order to assign any single patient to the correct diagnostic workup process as soon as possible. In other sense, the hospital like ours, where we are a multidisciplinary hospital, we get flu patients, we get patients with pneumonia, we get a patient with a respiratory problem, and there are heart patients. For us, this is very mandatory that we should have a multidisciplinary approach to any patients who comes with a fever, breathing difficulty, chest pain, to identify whether those symptoms are pertaining to pre-existing cardiac problems or those are because of COVID. Now, institutional protocol is very important, and explicit diagnostic algorithm for triaging for suspected COVID-19 infection is important. Patients with possible or probable or confirmed COVID-19 infection should be triaged as COVID-19 infection. Now, critically ill cardiovascular patients who has got like STEMI or who has got a cardiac arrest out of hospital, they should be presumed as SARS-CoV-2 positive until proven otherwise. Accordingly, healthcare personnel should bear adequate PPE, particularly in the triage phase. COVID test must be sent as early as possible. Patient must quickly access medical or international treatment according to the current evidence-based guidelines recommendations. In other words, any patients who comes with STEMI or who suffered cardiac arrest outside the hospital and revived, now these are the patients where we cannot wait for COVID test reports. We have to consider them as a COVID patient and start treating as early as possible. For that, our healthcare workers who are going to involve in the treatment, doctors, nurses, paramedics, they should have adequate protection in form of wearing adequate PPE, N95 masks, gloves, headgear, whatever is mandatory to prevent themselves from not getting infected. Now, in Manipal Hospital, we have developed a protocol where any patient who comes to the hospital, they enter from a one gate where the medical personnel record their temperature. If temperature is normal, then patient can proceed. If the temperature is more than normal, he has symptoms, then those patients are referred to a flu clinic. In flu clinics, their symptoms is being checked, history is being taken, and if there is suspected COVID-like symptoms, then they are referred to the ER room. In ER room, if it looks like a COVID patient, then X-ray is being done, and accordingly, if it looks like more close to the COVID, then they are referred to the COVID hospital. Otherwise, those patients who are not very close to the COVID symptoms are sent to the hospital where we have got a designated area for medical and surgical patients. Now, if it is a medical patient, they go to one area. There is a single room for each patient. And if they are for waiting surgery or any procedures, they go to our other floor. And then the COVID test is being sent, and they are treated like a COVID till we don't get a COVID reports. Once the COVID report is released, turn out to be negative, then the medical patients are being referred to the CCU, and the patient for procedures, they are go to respective ward. So this is a protocol which we are following, and I think this is one by which we could able to identify and shift some of the COVID patients to the COVID hospital. Now, there is a situation when a patient who is very serious and require immediate ventilation, if they are in our facility, then there is no other way but we have to intubate, taking all the precautions, considering that is a COVID patient, and then we have to keep in our designated SDU, considering a COVID patient with all precautions. We send a COVID test, and if turn out to be COVID, we have to treat, because the ventilated patient we cannot shift to the COVID hospital. So this is a protocol which we are following, and I think this is appropriate. Now, the protocol for diagnosis, trial, isolation, and management of COVID-19 patient with cardiovascular complication and our cardiovascular patient with COVID-19 should be developed in detail and should be rehearsed, because most of the cardiovascular experts, they are not earlier dealing with these kind of situation. They are not well versed with donning and doffing of the PPE, putting N95 mask, gear, and taking all the precautions. There are instances that during doffing, the healthcare individuals, they get infested because of the virus. So this everything is very important, and there should be a proper protocol, and the infection control department of the hospital should be involved to train repeatedly and rehearse to healthcare workers, including cardiologists and cardiac surgeons. Now, specific protocols should be developed for management of acute myocardial infarction in context with the COVID-19 outbreak, both for patients with and without COVID-19 diagnosis. Now, particular emphasis should be placed on acute PCI and CVG, including protocols to limit catheterization lab or OR personnel to minimum. Whenever internal ventilation procedure is being done, angiography or angioplasty, there should be very minimal manpower in the cath labs, same in operation theater. Predetermining requirement for enhanced personal protection, that is PPE, assessing post-procedural sterilization sufficiency. Once the procedure is done, one must follow the sterilization protocol and shut down the facility for 1 hour before taking the other patients. Thrombolysis is preferred in acute cases after acute clinical assessment, and this is worldwide. If there is not much complication and if there is no contraindication for thrombolytic therapy for acute myocardial infarction, thrombolysis is the first choice. In extreme circumstances, clinical leadership may need to assess the risk-benefit ratio of acute myocardial infarction intervention. Given a limited data on primary PCI benefits for type 2 MI from acute viral illness against nosocomial infection, it means that one has to weigh that healthcare workers may get nosocomial infection as compared to the benefit of PCI in a patient with acute myocardial infarction. And accordingly, if there is no contraindication for thrombolytic therapy, I think that should be preferred. Now, what happens to the patient who are hypertensive, who are at home? They must continue taking their antihypertensive drugs. They can contact their doctor on telephone or on teleconsultation. They should monitor their blood pressure and try to inform the healthcare providers, their doctors, what is their status. Now, the patients who are admitted in the hospital with their hypertensive crisis, they should manage according to the protocol. They must continue ACE inhibitor ARBs unless hypotensive or there is an acute kidney injury. Continue treatment with antihypertensive medication according to the ESE and ESS guidelines of 2018. Some of these patients may develop cardiac arrhythmias. One must check their potassium levels. Some of them, they develop hypokalemia, and because of that, there may be arrhythmias. Parenteral antihypertensive medication will only rarely be necessary in ventilated patients. Now, let's see what are the acute cardiac complications of COVID-19 patients. There are now immense reports available from China, from Italy, from Spain, and now from United States of America, that there is incidence of acute onset heart failure, myocardial infarction, myocarditis, and cardiac arrest in COVID patients. In a recent case report of 138 hospitalized COVID-19 patients, 17% of patients, they develop arrhythmias, and 7.2% experience acute cardiac injury, in addition to other COVID-19 related complications. So the cardiac team should be prepared to assist other clinical specialties in managing cardiac complication in severe cases of COVID-19. One must advise troponin, BNP can be sent in high risk cases. Patients demonstrating heart failure, arrhythmia, ECG changes, or cardiomegaly should be advised echocardiography. Critical care and cardiac teams should confer to guide care for patients requiring extracarpular circulation support with veno-venous ECMO versus veno-arterial ECMO. There are reports from France that they have very good outcome from VV ECMO in a patient who are not able to manage with intubation and prone ventilation. But the same good VV ECMO results are not being duplicated in another part of the world. In China, they have very significant mortality, around somewhere in 80% mortality of VV ECMO patients. So one has to see, and if when to put a VV ECMO, one has to put VV ECMO in little advance, not too late when already some complication has occurred. But one has to weigh when to intubate, if one can try to avoid intubation and give even a prone position and give a BiPAP or CPAP, it's better than invasive ventilation. Now, after intubation, if patients could not able to sustain the PO2, then one can consider VV ECMO. Now, let's consider what is the emergent or urgent procedures which are really required in this COVID pandemic time, or which are the elective or non-urgent procedures which can be postponed. Now, the pandemic can be divided into three stages. In stage one, The hospital works with reduction of around 0 to 30% work of routine cases. Now in that stage one, the essential services like all patients who are waiting in surgery, including emergency surgery, they should be given services. Outpatient who are greater risk of adverse event like symptomatic critical AS, symptomatic severe coronary artery disease with left main disease, three vessel disease with low EF, cardiac tumors at the risk of obstruction or embolization, aortic aneurysm at the risk based on the very rapidly increased size and threatening ruptures, or patients who require TAVI for critical AS, these essential services should be rendered to our patients. Now, what are the procedures which can be deferred? All other patients who will mainly be least symptomatic outpatients, they should not be admitted and should not be given a further treatment. Truly elective intervention could include asymptomatic severe MR, ASD and PFO surgery, asymptomatic aneurysm with a demonstration of a stable size which are not increasing. These patients can wait. But one must take precaution that patient should be informed the prevailing COVID situation and ask that they should inform if any emergency develops and if there is some acute catastrophe, then those patients should be admitted and should be given appropriate treatment. Otherwise, patients can wait. Now, if the pandemic reaches into the stage two, where most of the hospital, they reduce their works from 30% to 50%. In that situation, the essential services like all inpatient waiting for surgery, including emergency services, they should be given a treatment. Outpatient who are most symptomatic and demonstrated to fail medical management, which are not responding to medical treatment, they can be admitted and they should be given appropriate treatment. Patient who are waiting for TAVI and who require very short hospital stay, they should also be given TAVI and they can be discharged early. What are the procedures which can be deferred? All patients who will mainly be least symptomatic and outpatient, they should not be dealt with at this time. But these patients who are deferred from the proper procedure, they should also be informed if they are in the waiting list and the date has been given to the prevailing situation, and ask them, they should also contact the service provider if there is some complication develops and symptoms become really bothersome. Now, if the pandemic reach in the stage three, where more than 50% reduction in the hospital services, then only very essential services like only emergency services based on resource availability and most urgent inpatients who are already admitted, they should be treated. Now, what are the patients who are being deferred? All patients just to be stable and capable of waiting. All outpatients, they should not be admitted. Patient deteriorating while waiting would need to meet criteria for admission before consideration for surgery, all other TAVI procedures. But again, these deferred patients or who are waiting for procedure should again be informed about prevailing situations and ask them to report to the healthcare provider once there is some catastrophic, some emergency or exaggeration of the symptoms. Now, one can divide based on case-to-case basis, like patient who are ischemic, has got heart disease. Now, which is emergency, which is urgent, which is lower priority, which is elective cases, and accordingly they have to deal with. Same valvular surgery, acute or chronic heart failure, patient who has got arrhythmias, heart block, and other intervention, they should be categorized depending on the priority, emergent, urgent, lower priorities, and elective cases, and accordingly they should be treated or given dates. Now, patient with a STEMI during COVID-19 pandemic, any patients who comes to your hospital with STEMI, treat him like a patient of COVID with STEMI, and accordingly see whether the patient can be a candidate for fibrinolysis or primary PC. Now the patients who are self-reporting to particular hospital, if they turn out to be a COVID patient, they can be referred to the COVID hospital where there is a 24/7 cath lab so that they will manage there. If not, then they can be given fibrinolytic therapy depending on their situation and if there is no other contraindication. Now, patient with non-ST segment elevate acute coronary syndrome. Now, their symptoms should be whether they are high risk, very high risk, intermediate risk, and low risk. Depending on that, they should be treated whether they need a PCI or they can be easily managed with a thrombolytic therapy or other conservative treatments. Now, this is very important to that our healthcare worker should be prevented for getting infection. This is really, really important. Particularly when we getting patients who are in the cardiogenic shock or who has a cardiac arrest out of the hospital. Now, these situations, these patients should be treated like a COVID patients, and all the necessary precaution should be taken with full PPE, N95 mask, gloves, goggles, and accordingly these patients should be treated depending on their prevailing situation. Now, risk to the healthcare personnel, this is very important. This has been seen that a lot of healthcare workers, they are getting infected because of their close proximity to the patients. So one must, there is a numerous report worldwide, and also now some of the reports are emerging from our country itself, that a lot of healthcare providers, they are getting infected. And a lot of infection, I already narrated that, maybe because of doffing when they are taking out their personal protective equipment, they get infested. So one has to be very, very careful. This is a responsibility of administrator, infection control team, to train the manpower very judiciously, repeatedly, so that they may not be get infested because of doffing, because of close proximity. Now, if a healthcare worker, they get some symptoms which are already mentioned, cough, fever, shortness of breath, insomnia, muscle ache, they immediately should be quarantined. The test should be sent, and if they turn out to be COVID positive, they should be either shifted to the COVID hospital, or if there is a provision to keep in the same hospital, they should be treated accordingly. And their contact should be traced, and they should also be quarantined. Now, various protective gears which a doctor should need, healthcare worker should need, depend on the kind of procedure they have to perform. So this can be divided into level one, which is like outdoor procedures, what they have to wear, the cap, the mask. Now, if they are going for investigative room, then they have to put specific which are being shown here. Or if they are going for aerosol generating procedures or in the operating room, they should be given a proper N95 mask, FFP3 mask, or headgear, and whatever is required. So this one has to be categorized because available resources, the kind of procedures, and the involvement of healthcare worker to particular procedures, and accordingly one must categorize, and this is job of administrator to make sure that required gears are available to healthcare workers. Now, these are some of the masks. One can have FFP3, where even 0.023 micron particle cannot cross. Then there is N95. Then there is a powered air purifier respirator. Now, the problem with is that this is really cumbersome to wear, and particularly for us surgeons, it's very difficult to wear and perform surgery, because as a cardiac surgeon, we need a loop, and this is difficult when we are putting these headgears. Now, donning as I mentioned, is very important, and there should be continuous rehearsal and alert should be given to the healthcare worker how to put these protective gadgets. Same is for doffing. One has to be very, very careful. Then for the cardiac surgeon, we have got a recommendation from Society of Thoracic Surgeons, which has given that when any patients comes for any procedure, they should be sent a test, and we try to perform the procedure within 48 hours of getting the test report, because if we will, these patients will wait for more, then there may be infection during the waiting period. So this is very important. Another thing is that try to avoid any emergency in half hours, because the availability of manpower and everything is important. Now, when you are performing aerosol generating procedure, one has to be careful. Try to avoid aerosol generating procedures like endovene harvesting and endoscopic surgery. And most important, there should be minimal manpower present into the operation theater or cath lab, so that they may not get infected. We should have a bare minimum. Now, prevention is very important. Interaction with other or avoid people who are sick. Keep at least 2 meter distance, which is general precautions. Wash hand thoroughly with soap and warm water at least for 20 seconds. Cover the mouth or nose when you cough or sneeze with tissue or use inside of your elbow. Avoid touching the eyes, nose, mouth. To remove the virus, often clean surfaces like doorknobs or handles with disinfectant. Self-isolate in case of symptoms of fever, cough or chest infection. Stay home as much as possible and maintain physical activities. Now, healthy lifestyle is important. Do some yoga, quit smoking if you are, minimal use of alcohol, eat healthy. All these things are really important. At this juncture, we healthcare workers, doctors, nurses are in a very, very unprecedented situation. We get a lot of news which are bad news. We get depressed, so one has to encourage each other. Try to talk in telephone to your relatives, friends, watch some good movies, to read some good books, so that you can get motivated. Very important that you must get enough sleep. That is very, very important. And I know a lot of my friends, they use melatonin in the US, because at least 6 to 8 hours sleep is very, very important. Eat healthy. And and if there is some symptoms, try to report as early as possible, so that you can prevent others to be get infested, and yourself may get appropriate treatment before getting complications. Now, patient information is very important, and we are doing that as healthcare worker. So in nutshell, this is our responsibility at this juncture as a cardiovascular expert to take care of our patients who are already suffering with cardiovascular problems. And if by any chance those patients get infested because of the virus, they are supposed to be given appropriate treatment. The COVID hospitals, if they are getting admitted patients, those patients may develop a complication which are related with the cardiovascular existing problems or de novo because of the virus, and those should be also managed. Thank you. Thank you for patience listening. If there is any questions, please try to put me. I will be able to answer those. Yeah, because some of the medications which are being used for COVID patient, particularly hydroxychloroquine and azithromycin, these are the two medication which are really having some effect on the heart. And most important is the QT prolongation with hydroxychloroquine. So the patients who are COVID patients, And if they develop complications of the cardiac complications, so one has to be very careful before giving these medication. One has to see the ECG and see the QT. And if I know some of the patients whom the hydroxychloroquine is started and they have to stop because there was a QT prolongation. There are some deaths also reported. In our country, we know one of the cardiac anesthetists, he took a hydroxychloroquine as a preventive measure, and he has to succumb because of the complication. So there are some arrhythmias and there are QT prolongations. So one has to be very careful. There are some of the antiviral may have some bearing on the heart. So one should be very, very careful whenever you are using these, particularly the hydroxychloroquine and azithromycin. Now another question is what is the guidelines for primary PCI in a stable patient in this scenario? Now our hospital protocol is that whenever a patient comes with acute myocardial infarction, if he is stable, then we try to send the test, and if test comes negative, then our cardiologist take and try to if there is some contraindication for fibrinolysis, then they take for PCI. Now if a patient is unstable with acute myocardial infarction, then there is no other way. Treat as a COVID patient with acute MI and take into the cath lab with all the precautions, with PPE on, with all the healthcare workers, and do the needful. But the worldwide now the preference is for thrombolytic therapy. First choice, if they respond is fine, if they not, then there is no other way but to take for PCI. Why COVID patient has higher incidence of myocardial infarction and related complication? Now there is another question: why the COVID patient has a high incidence of myocardial infarction and related complication? Now this has been seen that the virus. There are two impact. One is the direct impact. The virus can go into the myocardium and produce myocarditis. So this is a direct impact. Another impact is secondary because of the involvement of pulmonary circulation, and because there is a diffuse thrombosis of the arterial system. So the coronary arteries, they also get thrombosed. And then there is a myocardial infarction. So there are two things. One is the direct involvement of the myocardium leading to the myocarditis, and second is diffuse clot formation in the vasculature, which leads to myocardial infarction. So these are the two things responsible for myocardial infarction and related symptoms in COVID-19 patients.